Last time, we proved Venkampa's theorem and then derived that if you take the fundamental group of the wedge of circles, then it's a free group. The rank was equal to number of circles involved there. We shall use that and try to do now the computation of fundamental group of any one-dimensional simplicial complex. Indeed, we would like to include the case like wedge of circles also. So we would like to extend the notion of this one-dimensional simplicial complex slightly a little more general. So such things are called pseudographs. Okay, by a graph, I will mean a one-dimensional simplicial complex. Okay, so a more general thing, a pseudograph, some people may call it just graph itself, but for me, a pseudograph means that you can have a single vertex and then a loop around that, or two vertices with many edges between them, which were, these things are not allowed in a simplicial complex, one-dimensional simplicial complex, remember that. Okay, so this, instead of defining like this ad hocly, I will do it systematically in a slightly different way, which can be useful for us in doing more rigorous mathematics. So here is the concept of attaching cells. Back to the first chapter there, wherein we had defined adjunction spaces. So this is a special case of adjunction spaces now. Okay. So fix an integer k greater than or equal to 0. 0 is also allowed. Let Y be a topological space and F alpha indexed family of continuous functions from SK to Y. So SK is the sphere of dimension K. Okay, so I have an indexed family of functions. K is fixed, by the way. Okay, alpha is varying. There are a number of them. It may be 1, 2, 3, and any number of them. Okay. Take A as disjoint union of all these, the disks of one dimension higher, indexed again over the same set. Okay. The space X obtained by attaching K plus 1 cells to Y via the map of alpha. This is what I am going to define. Okay. This entire phrase. So this is by definition in the quotient space of A union Y by the identifications on the boundary of these, each of these disjoint disks, namely SK, I have a map here. So identify X with F alpha of X. X is an element of the boundary, which is SK. F alpha is an element of Y. So identify this. This you do for all x in the boundary of S alpha and for all alpha. Okay. If you have just one thing here, this is what is you would have called adjunction space. But here is the same adjunction space. This is A and this is Y and this is map F. Disjoint union of alpha, you can call one single F as the union of all these F alphas. So it's the adjunction space, nothing else. Okay. But this is a very special adjunction space wherein all the disks of the same dimension are coming extra from Y. So Y we have attached these disks, X is the resulting space. Okay. Now, A pseudo graph, I mean a space X as in the above definition, where I start with Y, a discrete space, just a collection of points and discrete topology. Okay. And the K which I take here is zero. That means what? I have this S naught, which is minus 1 plus 1, 2y discrete space. So minus 1 plus 1 is also discrete. So any function from a 2 element set to y is continuous automatically. Either the 2 elements here will go to the same element, or they may go to different element. That is the only 2 cases. Okay. Then I am attaching a 1 cell. K plus 1, k is 0, k plus 1 is 1 cell. That is what d alpha is minus 1 to plus 1, the closed interval. Okay. The minus 1 goes to some point of y. The plus 1 goes to some other point of y, maybe same point of y, doesn't matter. Take the quotient space. Okay. That will be called as a pseudo graph. Okay, so we will have this terminology. Y, instead of writing Y, I will denote Y as X naught. That means it's a zero skeleton, just like in the case of simplicial complexes. It is just the set of points, that is Y to begin with, and call it the zero skeleton. Okay, or those points will be called as vertices also. This is similar to what we have done for one-dimensional simplicial complex. Then Q, which is A union X naught to X, okay, this is the quotient map, okay, let Q be the quotient map. That means what? Q restricted to each one cell, okay, that is either the endpoints are identified or the endpoints are going to different points. So depending upon that, either it is actually a homeomorphism, or in any case, the interior, it is a homeomorphism. The endpoints may be the same, in which case the image will be a circle, otherwise it will be an arc, it will be an edge, ordinary edge. Okay. So X naught is actually, which is Y, is a subspace of X under this quotient map. So again, points of X naught are zero cells, or you can call them as vertices or zero simplexes and so on. So simplex word we will not use, because this is not a simplicial complex. Okay. Indeed, a simplicial complex, one dimension, can also be described by this one. Only thing is, then you have to put a lot of other conditions. Okay. A pseudo graph is, in this sense, a slight generalization of a one-dimensional simplicial complex. Clearly, it is locally path connected. It is connected if QA, the quotient map, okay, itself is X. All the points of Y are covered by the alphas, F alphas. Then it is automatically connected. Otherwise, it is not connected, obviously. Okay. Q restricted to A itself is a quotient map in that case. You don't need Y at all. Okay. Y is there because there may be some extra vertices hanging. So if it is connected, then you can define on this whole thing, this quotient space, just on A itself. How? Whenever alphas are going to same point, you identify them. Otherwise, don't identify anything. That's all. Wherever it goes to, F alpha goes something, Y, some other F beta may also come to that one, you identify them. So that is the way it has to be done. So this Y helps to describe those relations. Okay, otherwise it's more complicated within A, but it is done inside A. If you use why, then it is easy to see what is happening. Okay? So here is a picture of a pseudograph, how it could be different from a simplicial complex. So look at all these heavy lines, that is a simplicial complex. But I have attached a loop here, a one cell here, of which the endpoints have gone to the same point. Here also the same thing, here also same thing. Here they are going to different points, but there is already another edge here. So these are violating, these things are violating the simplicial complex structure. Alright? So this is the general picture of a pseudograph. Immediately you can see that if I put two more vertices here on this loop, this part becomes a simplicial complex on this part. Here what should I do? Here also I should put two more vertices. Okay. If I put one, it is enough, because this point and this point will be now a single edge. This is another edge. So this will be like a triangle. So here I can do with just one vertex. Putting two more vertex, no problem. What is the meaning of that? You are as if you are subdividing this pseudo complex. We haven't defined anything like it. Subdivide the bad loops, a bad edge here and so on, to get a simplicial complex. So the, in a hidden way, the one-dimensional simplicial complex theory can be applied to pseudographs also. Okay, I will use this remark again. Okay. Now I make one more definition here, namely, a connected pseudograph is called a tree. This is a definition, if it is contractible. As a topological space, it must be contractible. Okay, then automatically it is connected, of course. Such a thing will be called a tree. By a subtree of G, we mean a subcomplex T of G such that it's a tree. It must be a pseudograph on its own, but it must be a sub. Okay. For example, in this picture, you can remove this one and look at the rest of the picture. That is a subtree. So there is a subgraph, pseudo subgraph. Okay. So if I delete this one, then also it is true. I can just delete this edge and keep this vertex. Okay. But I should not delete this vertex and I can't keep this edge. Okay. So edge has to have, you know, a complete vertex. Where it is attached, that is the question. So both the endpoints must be somewhere. So here it's okay. So both the endpoints have gone here. Okay. So you can remove this edge. But you cannot just remove a vertex. You can remove a vertex only if it is isolated vertex. If you remove a vertex here, all the edges which are emanating from there has to be removed. That is the meaning of subgraph. Subgraph, sub-pseudograph. Okay. A connected pseudograph is a tree if and only if it is simply connected. So once it is simply connected, it will be actually contractible, is what I have to show. If it is contractible, it is simply connected, it is obvious. So I have to prove only the if part. Okay, so start with X, a simply connected pseudograph. Given a vertex V naught belonging to X, we shall define a homotopy X cross I to X such that X 0 is always this V naught and H of X 1 is identity map. For this, we first notice, because of the connectivity of X, that the quotient map, okay, restricted to A itself is a quotient map. This I have already remarked earlier. Therefore, constructing map from x cross I to x is same thing as constructing it on all these d alphas or j alphas, whatever, okay, the interval minus 1 to plus 1 copies of that cross I in a compatible way. Construct a quotient map on a quotient is always you can go back to the original space and then do that. Okay, so j alpha is I am denoting minus 1 plus 1. You can do d alpha, doesn't matter. And let f alpha from restrict is the q restricted to j alpha. The q is the quotient map. These f alphas you can say as characteristic maps. This is actually earlier notation, it was only defined on the boundary, but I can extend it to this f alpha is extension of this one to the interior. You can put f alpha hat if you want. So these are characteristic maps. Okay, given any vertex v now in x, since x is path connected, there is a path omega v starting at v naught and ending at v. Fix those paths. Okay, there may be many paths, I don't care. Take some paths like this. Now you define h of vt equal to omega vt. Okay, where I have defined h of vt omega vt. For each v, I have defined this one. For each vertex cross I have defined this one. That is the meaning of this one. Now let f from f alpha from d1 to x, again I am writing d1 or j, okay, minus 1 plus 1 this is, be the characteristic map from one cell of x for each of them, okay, there is one cell, on each one cell d alpha to cross I have defined the map, okay, this map g is defined by g of s0 is v0. S1 on the top is Fs. Fs is this map, F alpha. Every time I am not writing F alpha, that's all. G of minus 1t, okay, is, look at this omega minus F of minus 1. F of minus 1 is a vertex, right? F of minus 1 is a vertex. You take omega vt. What is omega v? Omega is a path from v0 to v. Okay, and at one comma t, you take its f omega f1 at t. Okay, so look at all these. What I have done is on the boundary of d1 cross I have defined a loop. Okay, on the bottom, namely 0 cross I cross 0, a minus 1 plus 1, minus 1 plus 1 to 0, I have taken it as V naught. Then from V naught, I go by a path Vf minus 1, omega f minus 1. On this part, omega f plus 1. Okay, on that part, these endpoints are joined by f alpha, namely by the simplex there, one simplex. D alpha. So you get a loop inside X and X is simply connected. Therefore, this loop can be, this function can be extended to D1 cross I. A function which is defined on the boundary of D1 cross I, which is D2 essentially, can be extended to inside because it's null homotopic. Okay, so x is simply connected is used here. Okay, g is continuous, so you can extend it. Since x is simply connected, you have an extension g alpha for each alpha. Okay, now capital G, you take the disjoint union over this one, so that on each restriction it is g alpha. All that you have to observe is that wherever you have identified, it is the same old thing for each of them. They is compatible. Therefore, this factors down to a continuous map H from X cross I to X. okay, by the very choice, when S is 0, it is V naught. When S is 1, it is the maps Fs. Okay. So therefore, it's identity map there. All right. So let T be a subtree of a pseudograph G. Then the quotient map G to G by T is a homotopy equivalence. If it is a tree, okay, then it is contractible. When we have done long back a result, when you can collapse a contractible subspace and yet the quotient map will be a homotopy equivalence. So I would like to recall this. Namely, when the inclusion map of this contractible space into the whole space must be a cofibration. Remember that theorem? So use that theorem to conclude that G to G by T, the quotient map, is homotopy equivalence. Namely, when you collapse a tree means it's contractible thing. Okay? Like a vertex can be collapsed. An edge can be collapsed. Union of two edges, if they are not a loop, they don't form a loop, that can be collapsed and so on. Okay, so this is what I mean. If G is a graph, this follows from T containing a G is a cofibration. By the way, this cofibration business was done only for simplicial complexes. But the situation can be converted easily to a simplicial complex because a pseudograph can always be subdivided by putting extra vertices into a simplicial complex. Now, let X be a connected non-empty pseudograph. Let T naught be a subtree in it. Then there exists a subtree in X. Yes, that's the T containing this given T naught, such that this T contains all the vertices of X. This is one way of telling that this is a maximal tree. You cannot make it into a larger tree by putting extra edges. Because when you put all the vertices are there, as soon as you put one extra edge, there will be a loop. So let us prove this one. A rigorous proof requires now Zorn's lemma or some such thing, or hand waving. It can be done and so on. But in the finite case, you can actually do this. There is no problem. For finite case, you don't need Zorn's lemma. Okay. So let tau be the collection of all subtrees in X which contain T naught. Order it by inclusion. Okay, in this collection I have an order, partial order. Now we shall apply Zorn's lemma and then conclude there is a maximal one. All of them contain T naught, the maximal will also contain T naught. So let Ti be a chain in tau, chain in this collection. Chain means what? Totally ordered set. We claim that union of Ti is a tree. Okay. So how do we know that it's a tree? Given any point in this union, it will be in one of the Ti's because it's a union. Then there is a path in Ti from X to some point T naught, because a tree is a connected thing already, okay, which will be also a path in T, and so T is connected. Okay, Ti is a tree, so Ti's are connected, but now I have proved that T is connected. Okay, now suppose omega is a loop. A loop means what? It is continuous function from I to T, therefore the image must be compact. Okay, therefore we know that once it is image is compact, it is contained in a finite subgraph, finite sub pseudo graph. Okay, it's compact. It follows that the image is contained in the union of finitely many closed one cells. Right? Closed one cells are means what? I have told you that it is just either edges or full circles, which are all contained in some TI, because there are only finitely many of them. Let us say all the vertices are in T1, T2, T3, and then take the maximum of them. In that TI, they will be all be there. But then this loop is inside TI, it is null homotopic in TI. But TI is a subspace of T, so it is null homotopic in T. Okay, therefore every chain has a upper bound. So that is sufficient condition for John's lemma. John's lemma will tell you that there is a maximal tree, a maximal element which contains belonging to tau, means it's a tree containing tau naught. All right, a maximal element I have got. Now suppose there is another vertex which is not in this maximal tree. That would mean what? Because X is connected from that extra vertex, you must be having a path coming to this T. That would mean that you will get a vertex somewhere such that the next edge from that vertex to this tree, the next other edge will be inside the T. Okay, so this is what it means. But then it's easily seen that this, okay, what I have done here, there will be an edge S which will have one endpoint in T and the other end is not in T. From the endpoint which is not in T, you can collapse the whole thing to T, contract. That means T union S deforms to T, or T is a strong deformation defect of S. Therefore, T union S is contractible. Therefore, T union S is a larger tree. That is a contradiction to T is maximal. Therefore, there are no more vertices. So that completes the proof that every tree can be contained in a larger tree, and the largest tree such that all the vertices of X are there. Okay? In particular, there is always such a thing. You can start with a single point. Single point is our tree, after all. So every connected pseudograph is homotopic to a bouquet of circles. So this is the corollary of whatever we have done. Finally, how does you get it? Start the pseudograph. Take a point, any point you want, there will be a tree containing that. That tree I will take the maximal one, which will have all the vertices in it. All the vertices of X are there. Since it's a tree, I can collapse it. Okay, then G to G by T is homotopy equivalence. What will happen to G by T? There will be all those edges which are not in T, they would become circles. Every edge which is in T has become a single point. At that single point, I will have some vertices, some circles. What are these some circles? Only for those edges I didn't say that all the edges are inside T, all the vertices are inside T. All those edges which are outside T, they will become circles now. So G by T is a wedge of circles, namely one point union of circles. The number of circles will be precisely equal to the number of edges which we have missed from T. Okay. So this is the gist of this thing. So starting with T naught equal to V naught, any single vertex, take T to be the maximal, okay, containing all the vertices, a tree containing all the vertices. Then X to X by T is a homotopy equivalence. All the vertices have been identified to a single vertex because T contains all the vertices. Okay, so all the edges in T and also have become to single point. So the edges in X minus T are the ones which survive. And how do they survive? They become circles, and two endpoints of these edges are identified as single point. Therefore, X by T is the bouquet of circles. Therefore, what is the conclusion? You take a pseudo graph which is connected. Take any point in it. Pi 1 of the pseudo graph with any point is a free group. That's the conclusion, right? So let the next theorem. Given a connected pseudo graph, pi 1 of x is a tree, pi 1 of x is a free group of rank equal to the number of edges outside any maximal tree in X. Therefore, this number is independent of what tree you choose. By the way, the maximal tree may not be unique. You can think about that. But the number of edges outside because of this will be the same. That is the beauty. Okay? So, that is something which you have done. Next time, we will use this one to prove a big theorem in group theory and some more topology later on. So that will be the last module, the last lecture for this theory. Thank you.